not a panel discussion so much as an open forum where you finally get to make all of those comments you've been holding in while asking your polite questions. But what I thought was really refreshing about the last speaker, about you, Catherine, is that like many of the people in the room, I'm very time poor. And so some of the skeptical activism that everyone's been engaged in to me seems fairly overwhelming for the maybe 20 minutes I might find in a week where I think, oh, now I can do some skepticism. So it's quite nice to be able to think, oh, actually, I can just use my money. That'll be nice. But I thought maybe we could just talk about that, just going one down the panel, of what you think you would recommend as one act we could do that would maybe take 20 minutes and might change the world. Yeah, sorry. And then we'll open it up to the floor, so...
Well, you could contribute to podcasts. I think that would be good.
Yeah.
No, in all seriousness, that's a really tricky question. I mean, it depends what you like to do, what you want to do, if you want to help in general, or if you have more specific. If you want to help in general, there are many things you can do. One of the things that I've found has been very effective over the years, and it sort of comes in little bits and pieces, is that if I'm out and about and I see something I think is a bit dodgy or questionable, I'll photograph it and keep it in the archive. And usually it just stays in the archive and that's fine, but sometimes that comes back and is incredibly useful. I was at a Newtown in Sydney. They had a big, every year they have a big fair, lots of people turn up, and they had a chiropractic tent there a couple of years ago, and they were making very dodgy claims, printed dodgy claims on their thing about babies and whatever, so I took a photograph of it. Eventually, that photograph led to us taking down that chiropractor and making complaints. His name was Wiener, I think. So it's little things like that, but it's a really tricky question. I know it depends on what you want to do and how active you feel. Keep your eyes open for a start, is what I would suggest.
Loretta?
Well, I have a bit of a list here, but it's people that have more time,
So retire early would be
3 minutes
well spent retiring.
But I thought for those of them that haven't got the extra time, they could join Susan's group. Or the other one, they could put in a complaint. But if you've got less time than that, the one thing we really need is commenting on Facebook, for example. Absolutely crucial to just spend some time, have a look, and put a comment in. We really need people out there doing comments. And that can take less than 20 minutes a week.
Yeah.
So we've got a few categories here, 20 minutes a week upwards. I'm not sure what the minimum time is for you, Susan, but it could be
I'll take all your time.
So a bit later on I'll talk about the other things to do if we've got a little bit more time.
Thank you.
I like your suggestion, and I used to keep a text file, which I called Nautilist, which is any cracker I saw, I just added an empty list. Eventually it became unmanageable because I was getting much longer, faster, and shorter. But that idea of having something around you can use to document that stuff, and you see it. Making a complaint doesn't have to take a long time. Basically, you show, here's what they're saying. They haven't backed it up. That's it.
It ties in what Loretta was saying. If you want to make a complaint, you can have some evidence.
It doesn't have to take one. You don't have to write like a whole report or anything. You don't have to say this is wrong. It's unsubstantiated. You can send it in that cheat sheet I put up before. It's about lowering the bar, right? So it's easier to complain, takes less time. So it's one thing you can make, be something. You can make a material difference if you can get just one antique of the other, right? And then that can be used later by other people as precedent. It can be really handy. And then the next time you've got 20 minutes in your week, you can follow up and see what's happening.
Thank you.
Well, I'm worried about speaking and having it jump back at me. Besides the DSW project, which obviously does take a lot of time, a lot of things I talked about yesterday, can you hear me okay? Were to rate podcasts, rate books on Amazon, Patreon, supporting people, even $2 or $3 a week. Try to think wisely about who you're donating your money to. Are they actually effectively using it for the best? And I think supporting small little groups, you know, like a podcast or somebody who functions, just needs a few $100 a month. I think that you feel like your money's going farther and they could have support. So 20 minutes a week, you could write a podcast, you could go through your book list of everything you've read and just immediately go through it and raise the the level of all the people who write books in our community. Just support them. And as she said, you know, if you're commenting on Facebook, that's a help, liking and sharing things. And there's a lot of things, Web of Trust. Oh, I was going to mention, I don't know if it's still working, but there was a thing in the UK called Fish Barrel. Does anybody know anything about that?
Yeah, I do.
I'm
so
still using it, but it's effective.
Fish Barrel, I actually put in an edit to that, so I made it work with the New Zealand Advertising Standards Authority. That was a while ago. They now have a new site, and it's a lot harder to do with the new site, but what I should do is go back and update Fish Barrel. Fish Barrel basically is a Chrome extension, which you install into your Chrome browser, and it lets you just select areas of text and take images, and you build up all the evidence together, and then when you're ready to go, you say, I'd like to submit a complaint, and it takes you to the complaint form for the organization you need to complain to, fills in all your details and all the complaint details, and then you just need to add a bit of text about why the things you documented are wrong. So it, again, it lowers the bar.
I've done it once or twice. It's a little bit of time to set up, because you get to install it, and you get all your criteria, your name, all that contact information, but once you've got it done, from what I understand, you just go to a website that's making a claim, and then you just highlight the text, you select it, and then you send it off, and it goes to the correct people who are supposed to be receiving the complaint. And I think it's UK, and so you said you used it for New Zealand.
I wrote the New Zealand part.
Oh, you wrote, okay, so that might be something that people could look into, maybe a more effective way of complaining, which I think is probably a great way of doing it, but like I said, it's probably a little of a learning curve to start with. So maybe if somebody has 20 minutes of help make a video or so or something to make Fish Barrel more effective so that we can, and trains other people on how to use Fish Barrel, and then we can be even more effective, because that's how I work is, I could edit Wikipedia all day, but I find it more effective to train others to, and recruit others to, so that I'm expanding my reach.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so since the question was, what can we do to, was it something like make the world better?
Save the world.
Save the world, okay. I've got two. So the first one is to go to one of those charity evaluation websites, like GiveWell or Giving What We Can. Find a charity that you like the look of out of their recommended charities and start a automatic donation that goes out of your, you know, account or something every month, because one of these things is, you know, if you set it up and it happens automatically, you'll do it. And there's also other things that people sometimes do is they sort of, they pledge to say, I don't need all my income, I could give away 1% of my income, and they make a public pledge, and having a public pledge can make a big difference to whether you do it. So if you're kind of inspired, just go home and do that, set up that automatic payment, and that's awesome. And then you can, you know, see it come out of your account and get lots of warm fuzzies every month. The other one is that you guys could choose to eat a little less chicken. So the reason why I don't like chicken very much is that they're quite small animals compared to the big animals, and also chickens that we get from meat have a pretty awful life. Like, they're bred to get really big, and then their legs can't like hold up their mass, and their heart can't deal with it, and they have a really awful life. And because they're generally small animals compared to like a big cow or something like that, people go through a lot of chicken in their life. So if they want to reduce the suffering in the world, just eating a little less chicken would make a big difference.
Well, Jersey chicken probably, where you buy chickens.
Yeah, pretty much. Although all of them for meat chicken are quite bred, even if they're free range, they're bred to go so quickly that all kind of crappy. But yeah, free range is a bit better.
All right, so now, thank you very much for that moment. Now I'd like to open it up to the floor, because I thought that would be quite a nice introduction to getting everyone else to be involved. So hands up anyone who wants to, questions, comments?
This is a question for Loretta. Mark, in your talk, Greta, you said that it was quite difficult, comparatively difficult, to get these sorts of health scams out of business and out of the public eye. You said it was more difficult than New Zealand. Could you explain why that is, Mark? You might know.
I think you're referring to the fact that we've got the ASA in the government, right? Because the ASA, although they don't have any legal power, it's really great. Well, they'll respond to every complaint, and it often results in an ad getting taken down quite quickly. Whereas we have to have legal wheels turning. It'll take months, maybe years, maybe nothing will happen. So we've got the ASA, which is really nice and effective for that. Whereas I think all of the tools that you have are much slower in that respect. Is that right?
We've got a section for complaints for goods that takes 6 months. There is no effective way of dealing with the services. But they just set up a new an ombudsman in Queensland, and if you look at the website, it's looking for the patient. So I've got no idea where to put a complaint in my own state. But in other states, like the work we've been doing against the Australian Health Practitioners Regulation Agency, the practitioners there, you put in a complaint, they set up a legal file for them, a case, and then you wait and wait and wait. Because the lawyers there can't tell you how long it takes to prosecute them. Well, so what we do then is we send them in 400 at a time, 200 at a time. Because we're not trying to prosecute one chiropractor. I think I showed you with the doctor from Perth that had the resort to health. The complaint was in 2009. It was upheld in 2015. That's an awful lot of money to take one person down. So what we try to do is to try to show the size of the problem, to try to get the regulators to put out communiques, which happened this year with the chiropractors, where they said chiropractors can no longer claim that spinal manipulation can alter the course of ADHD, asthma, allergies, bedwetting, colic, ear infection.
It's so helpful. So helpful.
And they should not be touching the unborn. And that took us 4 years to get that statement out. We have not got that statement with osteopathy, but I'm really happy to say in the UK on Friday, they've got one. So that was brilliant. So they've actually listed the conditions that they're not allowed to make claims on. I think that's a huge step to put that in. The other thing we do is when they do uphold a complaint, they don't publish them in their country. For goods they do, but not for services. So in documenting all the images from these 400 or 200 websites, 400 for chiropractors, 200 for osteopaths, I put them up on the internet. So they're there forever. And it's easy enough for me in 12 months to sit there and go through the 200, that's the beauty of being retired, and to do a comparison to see what's going on, because you really have to monitor them yourself. They just don't have the resources to do that. Yeah, so it's when I first took on advertising in this country, I was coming to speak at a conference, and I contacted the ASA, and I said, can I submit complaints? They said, yes. And I was actually bowled over. I came back in 2 months, and I thought, wow, how lucky you guys. So every conference I've spoken here, and this time I got really brave. I put a whole slide up. And I think last time you guys were doing it, and I just thought it's amazing. You can get the results in 2 months. I put a complaint in, I get some outcome, and I think, did I put that complaint? It's so long ago since I did it, yeah. So if all you can do is get rid of advertising claims, then that's what you do.
I think we've got another real advantage here as well. We're small, right? We don't have the inertia of a country like America or something. Changing things here is relatively easy. Doesn't happen overnight still, but like if all the people in this room were together, we could make a real difference. If we were in a much bigger country, it would be a lot harder. So we've got that advantage as well.
So for both of you, how do you remain motivated when things don't happen as fast as you want? It must be few and far between those moments of success.
Honestly, I'm not always motivated. I know that my motivation waxes and wanes, and if I try to keep it up and it's waning, I'd burn out. So I just let that happen. I know. Because I know how it works, actually, it's going to come back. So there might be a month when I'm like, don't really look at that so much. And then something will happen, probably make me pissed off. And then I'll be motivated for a while, and it comes back. So I try to be mindful of burnout, basically. Some people are great. Some people can just stay motivated the whole time. It's wonderful you want those people around. It's not everyone. Sometimes it might wane, and you just let it go a bit. It's okay. You don't want to burn yourself out, but you'll probably come back, especially if it's the sort of thing that annoys you. You know, you'll see something that will trigger your motivation again.
I don't wane. What I do is I take on a totally different topic.
and I leave that one aside for 12 months. And that works because you're looking at a totally new area, chiropractic, or it was, I took on mechanical devices at one point, and I documented 800 websites. I did one device a month, and I got an award for that because TGA, the first time in their history, actually cancelled 30 devices. And I didn't know the outcome of that. I'd arranged to speak at a conference, and it was only the month before that I got the letter, so I suddenly changed my slides to actually say, this is the device, this is the light machine, you put green light on to cure your heart conditions, it's been listed with the TGA for this long, cancelled October, cancelled October, and I went through, cancelled, cancelled, and that was amazing. So, so different years I do different topics. Next year I'm doing Chinese medicine.
Was that my trauma that light thing?
Yeah, we should use that.
Yeah.
I have a question here.
So next year we've got a general election coming up. So to me it seems that the most effective way that we could use our time would be to try and lobby political parties to get them to put on their policies that they provide more resources for agencies that actually protect the consumer, like MedSafe and so on. What do you think about that idea?
Two things I put on here. I wrote a list after I listened to Mark's presentation. I thought, well, that's my list gone. And I thought, okay, have another look. And I thought, all right, the two things I focus on first off is the media. Always number one. If you want any change, you get the media on the side. And the second thing is the politicians. And the reason that I always focus on babies and children, because that gets the media attention. And for chiropractic osteopathy, there is clear evidence that it has no effect. Whereas you're getting into murky waters with spine manipulation therapy. And it's something the media really want to take on board. We all saw that Melbourne chiropractor, Ian Rossborough, we thank Ian, that did more for our cause than no amount of work that we've done in exposing how horrific chiropractors are targeting babies. And so the thing is, you have to be aware of your audience's media. Now, the things you can also do with media is do their job for them.
Yep.
Give them the best cases, find patients, find the best professors or high profile academics you can, and they will help you, the academics. So when you go to the media, it's all there for them. Quotes are there. You'd be surprised how helpful they'll be. Media, it's a cutthroat business. They don't have the time to do all that work. Now, I'm blown away by the work Susan and her group, because that's more or less what she's done. It's all there. So they don't actually have to ring anybody up. So,
or they know who to ring up.
Or they know who to ring up. That's right. And but that's my target group, and that was just reinforce what I said. You get to the media first. The politicians follow, because you have to make it so embarrassing for them that they have no choice. And they're the areas that you, and as I say, you pick topics that, you know, puppies and kittens or babies.
Were you telling me earlier that the media need a victim?
That's right.
If you have a story that you want to promote about dodgy healthcare device or whatever, if you can present the media with a young mum of two kids who's the victim of a dodgy health device, then that's huge. You'll be, you know, straight up the ladder of success there. But if you don't, I mean, I've written to the media with various things that you saw me talk about yesterday with Stony Simons, and so what? They're not too interested. Maybe they will be. But if I had somebody who was, I could present this poor pensioner or this poor single mother from wherever has been ripped off by these evil companies, then that would make it more appealing to them.
That's sorry. Right, so if you can find any victims, yes, look after them.
Can I just quickly ask Richard, carrying on from that basically, when you don't have that victim, that person who's being done by health fraud, when you don't have therapeutic claims that are being made legally, so for the kind of stuff that the skeptics deal with a lot of the time, so the energy devices, the things that will pull moisture out of the air, or help get rid of geopathic stress and stuff like this, what have you found are the most effective ways of dealing those when you don't have such a clear-cut way of submitting complaints?
Well,
You tell me, and we'll both know. Well, I give this most startling case in my career was the power balance. And what happened in that situation was the media, a TV show called Today Tonight, played the story where one of their reporters was at an expo in Adelaide, came across this device and did all the tests and was amazed by it, and they did a story on it. That's what I originally saw. It was uncritical, saying, isn't this an amazing device? So when I saw it, I wrote and I said, I know how the tricks work. I can come and I can demonstrate the tricks that were done to you. So in a way, I guess, the reporter saw himself then as the possible victim of a con, you see. So, and then he saw the great story, which a lot of tabloid media love, put two people in from opposing sides and let them battle it out and see what happens. It's easy. And that's what happened. So, although it was interesting when we did the second story, it was very much downplayed that this reporter had been sort of hoodwinked. And he came across as the guy helping, you know, to expose the scam, which is fine. I was happy to do that. But that was a standout situation. I just happened to be the right person at the right time who knew the tricks. And I had a reporter willing to give to run that story, and the test worked. So all the little ducks lined up, or the Swiss cheese, you know, that analogy lined up in that case. But generally speaking, yeah, sometimes it's hit and miss, and sometimes if that's what the story people want to run with, the reporters, we hope we can get somewhere with these wall devices, this aquapole or whatever it is. There is a Scientology angle, which can be good or bad. Some people won't touch it because there's a Scientology angle. Some people might be interested. We're exploring our options with that.
So I was quite curious about how you feel about your kind of motivation, because other people on this panel, or this group, seem to have tangible things in them. How do you measure your success in what you're doing?
I do have a little page that I write up and say, I influenced this person. I told this person to read a book and they did, and so-and-so said that they had been donating differently, or so-and-so said that they're, you know, doing weekday vegetarian, or so I kind of try and keep a list of people who have said that I've made a difference to, and that when I'm feeling really dejected, I can just go look it up and say, oh, that's right, Arthur did that because I gave him the book and he decided it was a good idea. So I try and do that. I mean, it seems a little bit like self-congratulatory, but sometimes I need it.
I think you really have to, though. Yeah. Donations don't necessarily make good media coverage until it isn't this waste for what we're doing, and I suppose you're not going down that road of waste, but...
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how to sell the idea of effective altruism in the media, and but yeah, it's not anything that the media probably want to get at unless you're clever at selling it. I don't know.
While you were speaking, I just had another thought about this, carrying on from that. There's another device, well, there are two more. There's Shoesy, who is a New Zealand outfit, which we chased out of Australia.
Yeah.
Sorry, they're back there now. And another one called NRG, blah, 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 whatever, which was a wristband, which was on sale in sports shops. And I bought one at full price, because that's what we do. And the way we got that stopped was we wrote an open letter to the company, the sports chain selling it. And we referred to the power balance situation, we did the science, we sent them a copy, and we published a copy, and we tweeted the copy we published. And within a couple of weeks, or in a couple of days, I think, a week, the Rebel Sports stopped selling the power, this thing, and a couple of months later, I was looking in my local trash and treasure store, reverse garbage in Newtown, and there was a barrel of these things for $2 each. It completely failed. And I hope it's because this trick of the open letter, this technique of the open letter had some effect.
I'd like to add to that. I went up to my local pharmacy and there was a huge cutout of Glenn McGrath. Now we all know who he is, perhaps, but not Susan.
Not Susan.
High profile cricket player.
It's like baseball.
Yeah, it's a sport.
Gotcha.
baseball on the belly. And his wife had died of breast cancer. And they had a foundation to raise money for breast cancer. All good stuff. And there he was hanging on to a bill of Blackmore's with a pink cap saying,
I have heard of this now.
$2 to this will go. Well, you know, in a state of shock, went home, got the camera, took a photo, and to make a long story short, every member of the board of directors got a report which had quotes from high-profile people demanding that they stop and that disappeared. Plus, it was in the media as well. I not only sent it to every board director, including Glenn McGrath, I sent it to the media, because what's the point unless the media takes the story as well? And the report had a nice picture of Glenn on the front. So that's the other thing. If you can take on, I've taken on Woolworths for selling pills, and they may be still selling them, but at least they got in the media. So media, media, media first. How can you get into that? If it's French selling it, they don't care.
But you told me that you're really into Twitter now, right?
I'm doing my best.
Twitter's great. You know, social media is a wonderful tool. We use it. This open letter, we published this open letter and we tweeted it. You know, thousands of people saw this and read it, and the companies were certainly aware that thousands of people were now aware of our open letter, so Twitter's good.
Oh, yeah, well, that's, as I say, I mean, Friends of Science and Medicine is 5 years old this month. So since that started up, I've stopped all these other activities because we've just been focusing on our own group and trying to work together as a team to hit the regulator. So I guess the first thing is media. The second thing is to go visit the regulators and sit there in front of them and tell them what the problem is and ask them what can they do about it. And they'll tell you sometimes the regulations are not there. And that's when you need to engage with the politicians as well. But yeah.
I've just got a couple of suggestions. I think we should be communicating more with Fair Go, the TV program, because they seem to be concentrating more on things like advertising awards for good ads and bad ads, which is sort of, you know, just TV people congratulating themselves. So, you know, perhaps we should be sending in more complaints to them or suggestions to them for things to, for them to investigate. And the other suggestion is we had a member of our Facebook group, Lachlan Forsyth, who's a journalist who won one of the awards last night, and so I think he could possibly, I mean, I know as a journalist he has to be independent, but he is a member of our group, so that's...
I think he's just left New South Wales. I don't know where he's at.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I think New South Wales is a bit keen, doesn't
it? Sorry, I mentioned Martin Harris. Actually, I was trying to remember his name, but every time I think of his name now, it's never Martin Harris, it's Martin Harris. But no, how he won the Supreme Award at the Pharmacy Awards, it said, remember, these supported by evidence. The chiropractic stuff we done, we thought to look for this after we saw, oh, I got a Google alert, so-and-so has won Chiropractor of the Year. I wonder what their website says. Oh, Pollock, what the fuck? And there were a few. There were a few who won Chiropractor of the Year, who got the study stuff. So I wonder if they might be included in that sort of thing. Because then you can show, you know, it's not someone that's shunned within the community. They're at the top. They're being awarded by that industry. So maybe that's the area. And you're right, FECO's a good one. Thanks.
We also have in our country the checkout.
Oh, that's great.
Is that here too?
No, it's on YouTube.
Of course it is. Yeah, if people aren't familiar with the checkout, it does relate a lot to Australia, though, I must say, but the general principles are sceptical. And I think about 2 years ago, I had a meeting with the people from the checkout.
What is it?
We had a little talk. It's called the checkout. It's a consumer affairs program. They talk about warranties or dodgy products sometimes and all sorts of things, but they're very sceptical.
And very, very funny.
Yeah.
I did that on the Neurofin specific products a while ago. I think that might have been how I found out about it. Because that's in Australia and it was here as well, and now both regulatory agencies have done something about it.
Well, they had one, for example, they had Nicole Kidman in her shorts bouncing around. But what they did is the guy from the checkout put the same outfit on and bounced around. Yeah.
That's
and
Swiss, wasn't it? Swiss.
Oh, can I say that about the media? definitely you have to engage the media. One of the things we've been trying to do with, well, not necessarily GSOW, is to really support when somebody writes a great story about something, we try to link it up onto a Wikipedia page, and then I try to tweet to them or whatever I can do to say, hey, your citation has just been used in this way on this Wikipedia page, good job, and try to keep them aware of it. And that way, hopefully, we can go back to them when we have something that's going on, like with one of my psychic stuff. We would be able to go back to them, and they would say, and we would say, you've helped us in the past, or you've done great reporting in the past. Same with the bent spoon, and we have another story for you, and do a lot of the work, like they said, for it. This is something that I, you know, you only have so much time, but this is something I'm trying to do. And all the work I've done with the grief vampires, not necessarily has panned out completely, but the articles are there, the information's there. It's only going to take one media person really to get interested, and all the documentation's there, all the, everything's done, we have recordings, we have everything. It just, you know, it should fall in the lap. It's just a matter of time trying to find somebody to, for me to try to really market it to them. But, you know, you could really take out a grief vampire pretty easily, and part of the industry, if we could just get the media's attention. And I think by supporting them and writing to them, and I've been doing a lot of on Facebook, tagging newspapers and saying, I just read this fabulous article by this reporter from this newspaper. And I've had a few of the newspapers actually come back in and like the post, saying, well, you know, thank you for sharing our story and tagging us.
Given how small we are, we often get news about, oh, some other country has done a story about something embarrassing for New Zealand. It's often really small stuff, but the fact that someone overseas remembered we exist is like news. So in terms of taking a grief vampire, I know we've got a couple of psychics here. Matt mentioned that there's going to be a second season, or another season rather, of murder. I wonder if there was a couple of overseas outlets writing about New Zealand psychics, if that might be picked up in the media. Hey, look how embarrassing it is for us.
Well, and Stu mentioned that one of your psychics that he had gone to with his wife is going to America, so I wrote down his name, so I'm going to check him out. But, you know, it is just a... These panels and these discussions, these conferences, people keep telling me, you know, why should I go to a conference because it's just speaking to the choir? We have to speak to each other. We need to network, we need to know each other. Now that, you know, I've been made aware of the GSOW and myself have been made aware of New Zealand, I'm so impressed by you all. And doing your history on your Wikipedia page is amazing. And I can't imagine why you guys are not, you know, so much more prominent. Australia, too, has done such an amazing job. In America, we aren't doing hardly anything. It's just, it's awful.
No, you elected Donald Trump. It's all
right. Make America great again. Yeah, it is the American skeptics, and I don't mind saying this on film. We aren't doing what we should be doing. All we seem to be doing is trying to become the next star of whatever, and we're, you know, putting out more podcasts and more blogs, and, you know, that's nice and all that, but there's so much work to be done, and we're not organized, we're not doing it. We get together in conferences, we give each other high fives. That's nice. But we're not doing it. Australia, you know, I listen to Skeptic Zone religiously, and I am so impressed by all the work.
Oh, you're my listener. That's
great. I'm so impressed by the work they get done, and same with the UK. The UK is doing a fabulous job. With the Good Thinking Society and a lot of the others, Nightingale and so on, they're doing a fabulous job, and I love hearing about what's going on. And we just need to be in communities like these. These conferences are extremely important, because just like Mark said, ooh, that gave me an idea.
There is one thing with the media. Now, you talked about complimenting good journalists. What I also do is, when there's a fairly questionable story, I'll actually write to the journalist, and I'll be quite positive to say that, you know, you're from a good magazine and all this, and I'll point out that some research that they might like to know, and I'll offer them help. And if you want, we've got great professors or whatever it is. Now, I haven't seen a big payback, but I still keep doing it, because at some point, they might. It might just take one. But I have to do both, or even medical magazines, and this is because I've got lots of time watching TV. If they publish something and it's clearly like the acupuncture, where I've said, look, did you know that the National Institute for Clinical Excellence in England this year dropped acupuncture off its list? You know, and I'll give them the link. So it's a bit not quite as good as your Wikipedia.
No, but it's
but I actually, if I can find their email addresses, and you often can, I'll just send them. And now and again, they'll come back to me and say something. But you just do everything that you can. I just, media to me is just so important.
Question for Susan.
Yes.
I used to be a litigation solicitor and, long ago. And I was wondering, in America, which is more litigious than us, although we get in there, do you get threatened, to sue you? Or, you know, the Scientologists used to close people down completely by tying them up with lawyers, but do you get any of that these days, or is that died off?
Considering Wikipedia or considering
just,
what we've
just
found
in
there?
General, just sort of
Wikipedia, we're safe. So Wikipedia has it covered. You can't, people have tried to sue editors of Wikipedia for doing things that they didn't like being on the Wikipedia page, and the Streisand effect takes effect. And groups like Anonymous and things like that. Anybody who tries to take down a Wikipedia editor is laughed at. You just can't do it. You can't disparage anybody who puts anything up on Wikipedia at all. So, and if it's found out that somebody's trying to do it, like I say, then people laugh at them, and it gets shared so much that they're shamed into oblivion for trying to do that. So Wikipedia-wise, we're safe. And they've got legal backing to take care of that. As far as the grief empires and things like that, I have to be very careful. And again, I don't participate in any kind of ad hominem, any kind of attack where I'm disparaging them personally, but here's the fact. And so I write for Psycop. When I wrote my first article about Tyler Henry, they ran it by the lawyers. I said, okay, here's this article. Can you just double check it to make sure that there's nothing in here that's litigious or anything like that? And they just ran it by the editors, and a lawyer or two, and it is fine. So, I mean, yeah, it is kind of a worry sometimes, but absolutely not. I haven't had anything yet.
Yeah,
knocking something wood, whatever.
You have very liberal libel laws. You actually could say quite a lot. The UK is pretty bad on libel.
It's getting better because of Simon Singh, one of us. And you know, we've stood up for him, and he's managed to change a lot of the labor laws. So, like Loretta said, you don't know where you're going to throw. You can throw a stone in the water all day long, and you see ripples, and nothing ever happens. But one day you might throw a stone, and somebody's just happened to be looking at the right time, and you know, it's the next big thing, or it's a Loch Ness monster photo. I don't know, but I mean, you can't tell, and you just keep throwing it out there. Like the articles I'm writing about the grief vampires, it might be 5 years, but somebody might all of a sudden go, hey, wait a minute, we got this. And then they know who to contact, because they're already all, the information's already gathered, just waiting for some media person to get interested and contact the people who we've put on the Wikipedia pages as representing this. And there's a creds, and it's easy, the work's done. We just gotta get the media interested.
That's fine.
Mark. How many times have you written...
Hold it close to your mouth.
Sorry. You wrote to, I can't remember which newspaper it was, about an article that was incorrect and they took that down.
Is that the colloidal silver one stuff?
Yes, it was a colloidal silver one. How many times have you written to newspapers and said this is a load of rubbish and had any success?
That's definitely the one that was the most successful one. So I mentioned briefly in my talk, we've got the Press Council, which is something that newspapers and magazines have got together and said, okay, we're going to regulate ourselves this way, we'll all agree to abide by these principles. And the complaint process for that is first complaint to the editor, and then if you're not satisfied with their response, you don't get one, then you can escalate to the Press Council and just tell them you're going to consider to do that. I think I've only done it that much twice. I might be forgetting one. The first one was... in the White Above the Tiger's Age, there was an article about hunger media becoming more popular, and it was very uncritical, and I thought it wasn't sufficiently balanced. So I complained to the editor. His response was interesting. In a Facebook group where a bunch of reporters were talking about the needles, quite critical, he started this response with, you can all bite me, so I don't think he's happy with that. Well, ended up going to the Press Council, and I was pretty confident, but they didn't uphold him. So I said on the, their first principle is accuracy, fairness, and balance, or something along those lines. I said it wasn't balanced. You know, they didn't, this is certainly a controversial subject, they didn't ask from the personal point of view. They don't get the exception where it's a long-running issue, and we've talked about it before. They didn't really have any people coming from recently. The precedent it set was kind of worrying. I know the editor of New Zealand Pharma picked up and criticized the decision for God as well, but basically what they said is, we don't need to do the balance, so long as other people are being critical of it. So it's kind of worrying. The article stayed up. The other one was Stuff wrote an article very positively about colloidal silver, saying it'll fix this and the other thing, it doesn't. And I wrote to them, and they said, oh, oops, that shouldn't have passed editorial standards, we'll take it down right away. And they didn't, so that was really nice.
But it was nice that it has been taken down.
Yeah, they took it down immediately. That was a really nice response. I think those are going to be rare, though. It's kind of an editor's job to stand for their reporters, right? So in this case, they could say, oh, it was a mistake. I think maybe they haven't done the full process, I don't know. Generally, it's going to be harder. And I've kind of avoided doing that a bit because of that first failure, because the precedent is it makes it hard, because balance is often the way I'll go after it. If someone says something inaccurate, that makes it much easier, but normally they're a bit more careful because it's, oh, no, I'm quoting this person or something. It's been a bit hard. I think those are the only two I've done to that extent. Although I criticize them all the time, and I don't always complain to the editor. Sometimes it's like, hey, look at this crap that's gone up on here, here's the problems with it. I'll often, on Twitter, I'll be criticizing them for not linking to studies, and then providing a link to the study and saying what they didn't say in the article, that sort of thing. But I don't go to the editor unless I'm pretty certain that I can make a difference that way. Sometimes, I mean, I've written that a couple of times. Like, I got one recently, there was one, I think, in the Herald. There was a survey done by Jimbo's dog food, where they had like seven dogs or something, and they showed that bones held their teeth, but it was the most terrible thing. So I wrote about that. And so sometimes I think that might make a bigger difference. If I don't think they'll take it down, I'll think, well, at least I can get criticism out there. So it depends on how confident I am in what result I'll get, what option I'll choose, and probably my mood as well, honestly.
Yep, I've got a question for Susan. How do I go about signing up for GSOW? When can we get started?
I turn off my mic because this is just scaring me. Well, Mark, so I'll send this out as a general statement to you. Anybody else who might be interested, I don't take people to start at conferences, except you would be a nice exception. Because I know you've already known a lot about it. You're not hearing about it for the first time because, you know, a lot of times you come back from conferences, you're like, yes, I got to do something, and that sounds amazing. And I want you to kind of come down from the high a little bit and just kind of go, all right, I can do this. I really do want to do this. The majority of people who sign up, and it's a very small percentage, maybe half make it through training. And that's not because so much the training is hard, but maybe they just can't handle the... I don't know. I don't even know. They just kind of get quiet. You're just like, okay, I'm just, go ahead. That's fine. And that's all right. So we let people go off. That's fine. You have to open up a Wikipedia account. You have to send me an email, or I need your email. And you have to friend me on Facebook, or I have to friend you, because I need to be able to put you in the secret cabal. And that's a Facebook group. So like I say, if you're not on Facebook, you need to be on Facebook. Otherwise, we can't really... you won't become part of our community because we're a strong community. So if you never go on Facebook, you just have to go on just the secret cabal. You don't have to worry about anything else. We'll teach you. But then once I do that, I fill out some paperwork and things like that. And I have one person who's waiting right now in another country for me to start him. And I just haven't really had time in the internet connection to do it. But what I'm going to do is... It would take me a few minutes to get you started. I can give you the spreadsheets. Everything is your self-paced. You do it yourself. The lesson's already done. You have a spreadsheet. You're given a Google spreadsheet. You just check off as you go through, and then you just send me a private message or an email saying, done. Hey, Susan, I finished this. And then there's a few lessons that get a little longer in there that say, okay, I need you to check this before we make it live. And then... you just keep going, and my community on Facebook and the Secret Cabal really helps you keep it going. So we're a group, the community, that keeps everybody going. So this that's awesome, Mark's my job maker. So if you guys want to join with Mark, you know, he's this guy only does the good stuff. So just, you know, join with him and my two editors right here. But yeah, I did.
Okay. I just remember, I actually did a third one, I mentioned in my talk, I shouldn't have forgotten. Napier Career had a column, and I complained to them, the editor took it down after that.
So the success rate has been pretty good.
Yeah, well, the first one was a failure, and I stopped success.
You've had three, you've had two, so yeah, that's a good success rate at this stage, isn't it?
I think the first one made me filter the other one, so I was only trying when I was really sure it'd be successful. This one failed first, because like I said, Peter Griffin funded it first, and they said no. They actually made a comment about the columnist also being an advertiser there, which I thought was kind of like, didn't say that to me. But yeah, so I've done that.
All right, so I'm now leaving this with five things to do. So taking photographs of things, commenting on Facebook, keeping the list, documenting everything, editing Wikipedia,
or
whatever I can, and talking to the media, and setting up a regular donation. So that's my five things. What are you off to do now, apart from save the AGM?
It actually looks like we might not be able to do the AGM. It looks like we don't have the treasurer's report because our treasurer went and broke his back. So he drove over a roundabout and flew through the air for maybe about 10 metres. It was a pretty impressive thing. But so we don't have that, so we might just be canning the AGM. So we'll have it online in a couple of weeks, I think, maybe.
Okay, so in that case, any final comments from the floor? Or else we'll just go through the line and you can say all of your last wrap-up things. Mm-hmm. So.
This is a question for the Australians. How's Ginny McCarthy going? I haven't heard much from her.
Very good.
Ginny McCarthy?
She's American.
I thought she was big in Australia. I'm clearly wrong.
Well, that's okay. I don't mind at all, but it's funny to say a question for the Australians. I have not heard much from her recently. Generally speaking, it's... excuse me. I think I've got the... I need the homeopathy. Come on. It's in the form of chocolate cake, by the way. generally speaking, she was and probably still is a strong anti-vaccination campaigner. Or they say that they just want to improve vaccines and make them safe or whatever. At the heart, that it's anti-vaccination. We have had terrific success in Australia fighting the movie Vaxxed, which is doing the rounds. We've had at least one showing cancelled, which is really good, by our action, our strong action. There's another one slated in my state of New South Wales soon, I think, and we're keeping tabs on that, and they're trying to keep it secret where they're going to be showing it. But generally speaking, our relentless action against this movie has paid off so far, and yeah, you've got to be vigilant, and you just got to keep at it, even if you don't want to get out of bed that morning, or you're sick to death of it, and you burn out. Sometimes you've got to put your burnout on hold when there's an important issue coming.
Richard, talk about Tenpenny. That was amazing, what you guys did.
Oh, Sherry? Sherry Tenpenny, that's her name?
Yeah, Sherry.
Yeah, a very famous anti-vax from the States was going to do a tour, and the time and months and years go by. I think it was earlier this year or last year.
I updated the Wikipedia page from yours because you guys started talking about it on the Skeptics, and I said, this is important. So we went in and started. Sherry Tenpenny, her Wikipedia page has all the details with all the links. So the links are coming from most of the Australian Skeptics.
Yeah, early this year, thank you. I do lose track of these things. When you're dealing with multiple things, and this is what I do, talk about burnout. Boy, I tell you what, I do get dates and times and places a bit. I need to look at your Wikipedia. Anyway, it was due to, and when I say my tiny part in this, but lots of other people in Australia, we got the tour cancelled. Mm-hmm. She did not come out to tour and spread her nonsense all over Australia, which was really cool. And she had support by somebody called Stephanie Messenger.
Stephanie Messenger, who has a Wikipedia page now. She wrote Melody's Marvelous Melody's Marvelous Which has a Wikipedia page.
And... For those of you who don't know, that was a book aimed at children to say what a good thing that it was to go and get measles or have the children who have measles and things like that. So, again, I reported it on the Skeptic Zone. I helped, apart from that, do my little bit, but it's the general effort of the Australian skeptical community.
Yes, I was so impressed. And your reporting, and I, because I listen to Skeptic Zone, a lot of the activism I do and I focus my team on is because I'm influenced by their reporting, because I see they're doing something. Like the Northern Rivers Vaccination group, that's a fantastic group that is in Mumbimbi, which has very low vaccination rates. So what my team did is we wrote a Wikipedia page for them to sponsor to help improve their media footprint, I guess. And I get a lot of our activism because of it, from that skepticism, just from what you guys do and your reporting and your passion whenever you're reporting it. So I think that if you have something you can do, support Skeptic Zone and the reporters, and if financially or however else, I do. And that increases their output, which makes people like myself and other people get inspired to do more. And it just is a cycle. You know, we just have to have each other's backs, really, is what we need to do.
And when you know you're even a little bit of a part of something like stopping an anti-vaxxer doing a tour of Australia, then at least one night in the month I can go to bed happy. You know, you can get a good thing.
Only one month?
Only one night? Yeah.
A friend and I have been writing a sitcom about people doing natural remedies as a money-making venture. It's called Alternative Wealth. And the first program, the pilot, wasn't about rebirth, and it's about going down through the slides, and it's just a whole piss take. I'm now, after your wonderful talk about the psychics and the mediums, I'm just so looking forward to writing that one. You've given me so many ideas.
Well, fantastic. You got all my stuff, and I'm happy to consult or turn you to people who are more knowledgeable than I am.
And one of the things that astounded me about when I was doing some background reading to try and get the ideas for different programs is that anything I thought was completely wacky, someone's done it worse. There's so many strange ideas out there. I thought, surely I'm just too extreme, but somebody is doing it. It was astounding. So anyway, Alternative Wealth one day.
I'd just like to follow up that one. Mark Hanna asked me the other day on instant message. He said, what do you reckon the chances that if we pick a condition and a therapy, that there is a website in New Zealand where they promise that that therapy will treat that condition? And so we started off fairly sensible, and we got weirder and weirder. And it took a long time before we found a mixture of condition and therapy where they weren't making therapeutic claims.
Reflexology and gout or something?
Oh,
I mean, it's foot, but they never do foot stuff with reflexology.
I was just at PsyCon in Vegas speaking there, and one of the men I met there, Craig Foster, he did a short paper presentation on future pseudoscience. And in America, people are, you know, American football, you know, we're all that protective gear, but we also know that people are getting concussions, and it's long term. There's effects on it later. So he did a whole paper presentation on a future pseudoscience of people trying to say that concussions are a conspiracy, because there's so much passion for American football, and that he's put that out there now. And we're like, okay, oh my gosh, this might happen, but can you imagine? So maybe there'll be a pseudoscience, or we'll be fighting, instead of anti-vaxxers, we'll be fighting the concussion triggers.
You can make up your own.
And there's going to be porn, and there's porn about it too. Whatever it is on the internet, there's porn.
I made up one called harmonic energy oscillation.
I did
a video on how to do all the body tricks, the applied kinesiology. I had my friend pull words out of my hat. She pulled out harmonic energy and vibration.
All right, so question, Sarah?
I'm on Facebook, and some of the posts that I like, palming. One of the main ones that I can't seem to work out how to word is when people say, but it's natural. Like, it's coming from one person, but it's a huge company that's making the vitamins.
I always turn that around and say it's natural to give birth in the fields, just squatted and giving birth.
Snake venom.
Well, let's make venoms now. Yeah, natural for some of these products when there's such a big supernatural element to how they work is kind of confusing.
But the point you're making is that a big multinational company and factories making a natural product, right?
Yeah. And then saying that it can't be bad, it's not big pharma, it's coming from a treatment pathway.
Often it's the same companies, if it's supplements, often it's the exact same companies, but they might not know.
Right. You know, I should point out, please don't argue with people on Facebook and Twitter. It is a waste of your time. Just don't bother. I've got so many people who join GSOW come to me and say, I've spent the last year arguing with people, and they're like, oh, God,
stop it!
Just take all that creative energy you have and do something else with it. It's just not effective. It might make you feel good at the moment, but I think you're probably losing sleep because your heart rate goes up and it's not good for you. So creatively channel all that energy from all that arguing to do something effective.
I always think of whose mind you're trying to change. Like, if you can have a conversation with someone in the open, we might change an audience's mind. Sure. You're not going to, like I said earlier, you're not going to convince an acupuncturist that acupuncture doesn't work, anything like that. So don't bother unless you can do some good mind. Also, I thought of I hadn't mentioned it before, but another thing that I'm kind of passionate about is organ donation. And a lot of people in New Zealand think if it's on your driver's license, that matters. That doesn't matter at all. So one thing you can do with 20 minutes is briefly talk to your family and tell them, hopefully you are, tell them your thoughts on organ donation, right? Because they'll be the ones who are asked if it's possible. No one looks at your driver's license. So that's something you can do. That's like long at all, you know, send a text to your mum, something like that, right? Or your kids, or whoever, whatever it is, let your family know, because otherwise there might be this opportunity for someone to die. I know someone who's alive because they have a lung transplant.
Send a text to your mum, Mum, I want my organs donated.
Sorry, can I just quickly read that list that Mark, Hanna and I came out with treatments and conditions?
Can I come up with that?
So we started off with chiropractic. We started off with chiropractic and psoriasis, and we found one pretty easily. Then we went to homeopathy and bursitis, no problems. Acupuncture and pneumonia, and then aromatherapy and flatulence, rolfing and headaches, and I think organ and cramps might be where we got.
This is the song. You have to write this song.
No, we found organ and cramps. So it was a Romy massage and bunions that we find.
I can hear the melody now. Romy massage. Organs and migraines go away. Right.
So we finish on the musical number.
That's for the conference next year, folks.
One thing I want to reinforce is that I've been doing the Twitter, and every time I put a very good cartoon on, it gets retweeted so many times. And humour works, like you check out. So that's another thing. If you can take the mickey out of the wankers, as someone said I was doing when I was telling you, well, use it. Humour does work, and that's what we love to check out. It doesn't always have to be too serious, but if you find any really good cartoons, send them to me. Preferably without some sort of copyright. Yeah, they're the secret numbers. As long as you keep trying to get busy over here. Yeah, protect your back. One thing I'm always aware of is if, trying to avoid naming names, particularly since Friends of Science and Medicine was set up, the first thing the professor said to me is buttonhole it, stop mentioning names. So that's important too, because like Dr. Ken Harper with the John Maddox Award in the UK, these people, they try to ruin their lives by, you know, and these people are, the law's just up there to protect us. And that just shuts down this process. It's just, it's not something you want to go to. So there's other ways of doing things.
Yeah. That reminds me of something I forgot to mention. If you complain to the ASA, part of that is you give them contact details and that gets passed on to the advertiser. So the New Zealand Skeptics is a PO box. You don't put your address in, you can use that, right?
Yep, so it's PO box 30501 Lower Hutt.
It's on their website.
So use our address for any ASA complaints if you want to at least have a little bit of privacy.
Be aware of that. I've made over 60, I think, and I don't think I've ever been contacted, but I know there are a couple of cases where someone's been contacted. We haven't had like sustained harassment or anything, but it's something to be aware of.
Yeah, I've been contacted. Gold has been phoned up by an irate Indian man who was pretty angry that he thought that their product didn't
work. I'm surprised that I haven't. I've made the most.
You will. We're scared of you.
Not that intimidating.
They know you do martial arts.
What's your number? I'll put you down.
All right, well, one thing that I found really kind of heartwarming is it's a nice mix of like complaining on this side and doing really positive actions.
Catherine and I can complain.
Yeah, we'll do it. So I'd like to thank you all for today. I thought it was really incredible and I feel really privileged and honoured to have been able to share this moment with you. So thank you very much.
I would like to say thank you so much. You brought me all the way from California. I am so appreciative. Thank you guys. I needed to be here because I really needed to see what you guys are doing and who you are. Please friend me on Facebook. Please tag everything. And bring me back in a year or so. I would really like to come back.
Thank you very much. Thank you.